Hello there. Art Basel Miami Beach has celebrated its 20th anniversary with the largest ever edition. Although worries over an ongoing war, inflation, and the current state of global economy loomed large, the event was marked by huge sales and strong attendance.
It's a great way to see a lot of art in you know, a couple hours. Probably you'd literally have to spend a month traveling to different galleries to see all what you could see here in a day. It's sometimes overwhelming, even for us in the business, to take it all in, but it's certainly an exciting affair to be at and participate in. Certainly with everything that's going on in the world economy, we have realistic expectations. The type of work that we show at this fair tends to be of a higher value. So we, you know, we don't have expectations to sell everything in our booth. That would be kind of unheard of.
Pinocchio is internationally defined by Walt Disney's colorful classic. But director Guillermo del Toro is now challenging that perception by bringing a darker perspective on the endearing character. Here's the story.
I want to tell you a story.
Guillermo del Toro's take on Pinocchio finds woodcarver Geppetto's puppet going on adventures once again. It's the same classic story, except it's not. See, the Mexican director has changed quite a few things. First, there's a different type of social commentary. Del Toro says the other versions are about obedience, whereas his is about disobedience. For him, disobedience is an important factor in becoming human, because it means not changing yourself for others. And to underline that theme, he set his tale in Mussolini's Italy. That meant the visuals also had to be different to match the setting. So, forget the 1940 cartoon's Technicolor style. Del Toro employs dark cinematography for his stop-motion animation. He says to remake the classic children's book in this unique way was a burning ambition, because animation and Pinocchio have been the two biggest artistic influences in Del Toro's life, and critics seem to be all for it. The Guardian believes this austerity and darkness was needed after director Robert Zemeckis' sentimental version of Pinocchio, which was released earlier this year. And the fascism commentary brings out the human drama by drawing the story closer to reality. And that pretty much defines the philosophy of Del Toro's filmography, using fantasy to give voice to human condition.
Life is such a wonderful gift.
As Ukraine grapples with conflict, museums are also concerned about preserving the country's artistic heritage. And they're trying all kinds of measures, from wrapping up their statues to, in this case, sending their artworks away.
These avant-garde artworks are from 20th century Ukraine, but they're now more than 3,500 kilometers away from the Kyiv Gallery and other museums in the country where they were once kept. That's because in collaboration with Spain, the National Art Museum of Ukraine secretly sent the artworks to Madrid so they could be protected. The exhibit called In the Eye of the Hurricane, Modernism in Ukraine, 1900 to 1930s, at Spain's Thyssen-Bornemisza National Museum provides a space for Ukrainian art to be celebrated with an international audience.
51 of these works have actually been taken out of the museums in Ukraine. So this is super important for us as a way to protect our heritage, that we managed to take the works out of the war zone, and they're now in safety in one of the best museums in the world and are hanging for everyone to see. So kind of that was part of the project that is very important, is to safeguard these treasures.
The paintings, ranging from figurative to futurist art, are from a turbulent period in Ukraine, with collapsing empires, a world war, revolutions, and the War of Independence preceding the eventual founding of Soviet Ukraine. But many of these works were locked away by Soviet authorities until they were back on display with Ukraine's independence in 1991. And in a video message for the inauguration of the exhibit, Ukrainian President Zelensky highlighted the similarities of those days with today.
At this exhibition, you can see Ukrainian art, which was also created in terrible times for Ukraine and for all Europe in the 10th, 20s, 30s, years of the 20th century. Tyranny tried to conquer Europe then as it does now. Terror tried to rule then as it does now. But just like in the 20th century, humanity must win now. Just like then, culture must win.
Zelensky added that art is needed more than ever, and organizers of the event agree. The show can be seen in Madrid until April. Then it'll move to Cologne, Germany for another 6 months to present visitors with the largest body of modern art to have ever left Ukraine.
After 5 years of preparations, the Museum of Broadway has finally opened its doors. Broadway's history and many other details of the musical industry are on display. Let's take a look.
The Museum of Broadway has brought together artists, designers, and theater historians to create an interactive experience. It is organized in sections that break down what Broadway is about.
It took us 5 years to create the museum, and it took several of those years coming up with the concept. And what we really landed on after we talked to a couple curators and other people within the Broadway industry was three parts. We have the map room that tells the history of how the theater district came to be. We have the timeline of Broadway, where we have exhibits of game-changing and groundbreaking shows, as well as then the actual timeline of Broadway. And then we have the making of a Broadway show, which is all of the behind the scenes roles that actually make a show come to life.
Theaters on Broadway Street have been around since the 1700s, so the timeline section had to be meticulously curated. The focus was to present the history of Broadway in a comprehensive way.
You know, a lot of the timeline, as you're walking through this immersive timeline of Broadway, you're getting this sense of, basically, the art that we have today wouldn't be possible had all of these other people not paved the way and broken ground and pioneered and really changed the landscape of Broadway.
The entertainment industry is famous for overlooking some of its most important players. Timeline Walls curator Ben West made sure that wasn't the case.
African American and female artists who were present throughout this journey and really an integral part of the evolution. And they're often overlooked, or they're often segregated in terms of traditional histories. And so my work is really putting them in the center of the story where they existed.
The timeline walls are not only about the past, and the museum plans to keep a future record as well.
The timeline continues on, I will say, as well. So when we get to the 21st century, the nature of how we're presenting the timeline turns into columns. And so we have a column for each year. And at the end of each year, we will add a new column that represents the activity happening in that respective year.
Broadway, as we know it, has been around for more than a century. With tens of plays and hundreds of performers on the stage every year, it continues to be an indispensable part of the showbiz industry. And it was about time this uniquely American art form had its own museum.
visitors at museums are usually expected to be quiet, keep their hands to themselves, and move in a slow pace. But this exhibition calls for just the opposite. Here's more.
A bouncy game of giant-sized billiards has taken over the biggest exhibition space at Arken Museum of Modern Art on the outskirts of Copenhagen. It's a reproduction of a 1970s installation by Austrian architect-slash-artist group Haus Rucker Co. And it seems like time, since then, has stood still.
You cannot see the difference between the pictures from the 70s and the pictures from now. It's completely the same. Maybe a little bit the style of clothing, but the movement and everything is exactly like it was. There's no change.
The installation brings movement and play to the static environment of a museum.
It's also okay if they just have fun. We need fun, I think, more now than ever with everything we are facing. But we are showing images of how to go across general practice that situates giant billiard within a wider context, that you understand that this is about architectural vision and utopian ideas. So hopefully you will walk away thinking that that sometimes unconventional solutions are needed, and we need this more than ever.
This bouncy castle-like contraption also aims to change the way people view hierarchy, society, and the world in general. And some visitors love the human connection it provides.
I think it's a nice idea to make art that like gets you to interact with other people. I mean, the kids might not have this much reflection about it all, but you know, you interact with people you don't know at all.
Others have a profound, almost philosophical interpretation.
If you're just laying down, then you are safe, right? As soon as you stand up in life, then the danger comes and knocks you out sometimes. That's what it tells me, for sure. Yeah.
Whether it's just for fun or to invoke deeper thoughts of today's growing social inequality and isolation, this installation couldn't be timelier.
Polka-dotted paintings, pumpkin sculptures, and infinity rooms. You know who I'm talking about. Yayoi Kusama's works are on display once again, but this time, organizers hope people will gain a deeper understanding of her life and art.
Dorian Chang, the chief curator of M+ Hong Kong, says, "The public knows Yayoi Kusama, but their knowledge about her is very limited." Now, the museum has set out to change that. With Yayoi Kusama 1945 to now, the largest retrospective of Kusama in Asia outside Japan, organizers hope to showcase Kusama's idea of art and how it helped her during a lifelong struggle with mental illness. The event is also a celebration of the museum's one-year anniversary.
Without doubt, Kusama is one of the most significant and visionary artists of our time. And M+, as the Asia's first global museum of visual culture, we feel that Kusama perfectly embodies that Asian position with a global perspective and experience.
The 93-year-old artist had a difficult childhood, so difficult that her first flower and pumpkin drawings were based on her hallucinations when she was just 13. And although she's become an icon in the art scene, she voluntarily decided to live in a Japanese psychiatric hospital for more than 4 decades. But she never stopped making art. And although her works are great material for Instagram, she wants people to look at their inner selves instead of only posing for selfies.
Organizing this exhibition during the pandemic meant that we had a sharpened awareness as well as appreciation of what her life and art represent, which is to acknowledge her struggles but never give up, and always turn to creative endeavors, including art, to always uplift and connect to others and heal yourself and others, which are exactly the words that we decided to put on the entrance.
That's because Kusama once said, "I create art for the healing of all mankind."
I think her works are beyond imagination. I don't think there are many artists with her level of imagination. She likes dots very much, and her own style is very special.
And that's precisely the curator's focus, to show the complexity of Yayoi Kusama through more than 200 works. Because for them, this isn't just about polka-dotted paintings or rooms. It's rather a life full of struggles that's reflected through art. And that art is the reason why Kusama is still well and truly alive.
Daniel O'Colley is a young artist with autism. It's one of the most ignored health issues in Nigeria, but finally, his work is getting recognition. Zainab has more.
All of these artworks on show in Lagos are by three teenagers diagnosed with autism. The exhibition was organized as a way to support people living with the neurodevelopmental brain disorder. In Nigeria, such children are often ignored and kept behind closed doors, according to reports. One of the featured artists is Daniel Okolie. He mainly draws inspiration from dinosaurs, but also anything that captures his imagination. And for one visitor, the whole experience is eye-opening.
This is like the first time that I would see like children's talent really like channeled. People seeing them for things other than their disability. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? Like, it's really beautiful. Like bringing out that part of them, realizing that they have other parts to them.
And Daniel realized that at a young age. He didn't speak as a child, and his mom says people just couldn't understand why he acted the way he did.
Because of this pattern of behavior or play, they would assume he has a mental issue. And you know how it is in this part of the world where you're told this boy has something upstairs. So it was hard, and most times I would hide him.
But things got better when Okolie got years of therapy, and that's also when he discovered his passion for art.
It helped me to relax, and it can be used for fun and recreation. Like every time when I come out of school upset, my art is the only thing that makes me happy. And I always use my imagination to use inspiration of my art so I can bring it to life.
And he feels like his struggles have paid off with the Art and Autism exhibition. The World Health Organization says around the world, one in 100 children lives with autism. As for Africa, the data can be spotty, but a study published in 2014 shows that out of more than 2,000 children studied in Nigeria, 50 had the condition. Experts say the government must push for early diagnosis and treatment. But for those who already have it, Daniel hopes his life will inspire them to follow their dreams.
Paintings done on fabric face dangers other than weather conditions, like wars. So centuries ago, painters aimed to solve that problem by working their brushes on stones. And an exhibition in Italy shows how these artworks survived that way for hundreds of years.
The Borghese Gallery in the Italian capital has put more than 60 pieces of rocks on display. The catch is they all have famous paintings from the 1600s on them. Painter Sebastiano del Piombo is said to be the inventor of this art form. After the sack of Rome in 1527, he decided to practice his craft on something not only time-resistant, but also danger-proof.
16th century sources tell us this choice was made for conservation, almost to make the works eternal. Sebastiano del Piombo had lived through the sack of Rome, this terrible experience of works being lost when the Landsknechts were in Rome. Hence, he invented this technique precisely to give the works a chance of greater durability. This is certainly one of the meanings of stone painting, the eternity of art.
But of course, despite their tough nature, even rocks can crack.
Very early on, it was realized that even stone is fragile. Their supports can break. And in fact, we found many that were cracked or split. So let's say that stone painting is also a part of the dialectic between art and time, on how to make the beauty and works of artists last longer. Painting on stone was definitely one of the attempts to achieve that.
And needless to say, the attempts have worked. And art lovers can see it for themselves at the Borghese Gallery until January 2023.
Director Sam Mendes is about to release one of his most personal films to date. Empire of Light stars Olivia Colman in what's called a love letter to both movies and his mother.
Empire of Light is set in the 1980s in a coastal English town. It follows characters working in a theatre, including Hilary, played by Olivia Colman. As she recovers from an episode of mental illness, a new team member reminds her of all the joys of life.
I mean, more than that, it's a love story between two unlikely lovers. And it just happens to be in the cinema that they meet.
Another world.
Director Sam Mendes says his mother and her struggles with mental illness inspired Coleman's character. But that's not the only reason this film is so personal.
As I get older, I realise how heroic she was to be trying to bring up an only child alone and fighting this demon. So that is how it is personal. And then also that era that I grew up and I was a teenager, the early 80s, the music, the movies, and the way in which I think I used movies as an escape from my life.
The film also taps into racial tensions during that period, and Mendes explains why it was important for him to bring it up.
It is depressing the degree to which things haven't changed in the last 40 years. But I think, you know, it's partly because of the big racial reckoning in the world that took place during the pandemic that I came back to this time in my life when my own racial opinions were formed, which was a time of great racial upheaval and political upheaval in my country, in the UK. And you know, that gave birth to great art, great music, great movies.
While Empire of Light has received mixed reviews from critics, its cast got a nod for their acting, especially Colman, who's praised for her career-best performance, which some say could even make the film an Oscar contender.
And here's the coming home.
The Western has recently made a comeback, and the newest addition to the genre is filmmaker Taylor Sheridan's TV series 1923, starring Harrison Ford and Helen Mirren.
You'd be Mrs. Dutton.
I would.
1923 is a prequel to Paramount's neo-Western TV series Yellowstone, and also serves as a sequel to 1883, which explains the origins of the Dutton family.
Jacob, you can't start a range.
Now it's time to meet Jacob Dutton and his wife Kara, played by Harrison Ford and Helen Mirren. The story follows the family at a time of hardships, with pandemics, economic uncertainty, and droughts all plaguing the American West.
Men kill quick.
The series is flying the flag for the Western genre that's now enjoying a revival. And it's hardly a surprise for Ford, who has nothing but praise for the Westerns of Taylor Sheridan.
Part of the cowboy mythology is an essential part of American mythology. But the Taylor Sheridan version of it is unique, and it's compelling in many ways because it does not simply present everything in black and white.
And for Mirren, the genre's setting also contributes to its enduring popularity. She says she's thrilled she got to work in Butte, Montana, and also applauds Sheridan for the way he tells the story.
I think this is what our Taylor Sheridan's brilliant concept is the telling of American history through this one family, which becomes very legend-like, doesn't it? It's like reading a massive Russian novel or something, War and Peace, you know. It's that kind of feeling of the huge sort of role of history.
Though Sheridan is considered one of the most important Western writers in decades, he once said the popularity of Yellowstone has more to do with the genre than the show itself. In that case, we might be seeing more Westerns from him, well after 1923 premieres on December the 18th.
That's it for this episode of Showcase with me, Elif Bereketli. From me and the whole team here in Istanbul, thank you for watching and goodbye for now.